We gotta get to work, man. All right. Played the whole song.
Oh, man.
Good morning. Welcome to Community Voice. I'm your host, Keith Parris. I want to thank everybody for joining us this morning. Good morning, Carvey. Morning, Jermaine. What's happening?
Good morning there, sir.
My wife loves you, man.
Well, God bless you. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Who's that, Jermaine? I say, hey, man, this is Jermaine right out. First time we, and she remembered the first time we had a conversation. Uh-oh. I don't know who we was ragging on, man. And you just went in on him, man. I don't know who was talking about. And let me do this because it's on my mind. Me and Jermaine was just talking about this off air. I'm just because. Shout out to Bishop Daryl Hines.
Bishop.
Shout out to Bishop Daryl
Hines. Yes, sir.
Man, I, as I always joke, one of the few people I ever met who talk in key. But we were just talking about his musical acumen.
Yeah.
And there was a particular song that he wrote. All that I have,
yeah.
I give it unto
you.
Yeah. So great. So shout out to Bishop. And shout out to Bishop Designate.
Yeah.
Mr. Aaron Robbins.
Yeah.
Bishop.
Congratulations.
Right.
Man.
He just got Ontario. That's Canada, right?
Yeah, that's Canada.
Yeah. Now he's originally from Detroit.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so but shout out, good brother, man.
Yeah.
So I'm really, can I say I'm proud of him?
Yeah, like, of course.
I didn't have anything, but really proud of him, man. And I know he's going to do well. And hopefully. I joked with him. I said, dude, if I ever get a church, you preaching one of my installation services. But I'm probably not going to get a church or you're not coming.
Hey, man.
All right, man. Who would ever let me pastor a church?
Hey, man, then you'll be surprised.
I would not be. And I'm a Baptist. Dang. And so I was joking. Anybody can be a Baptist. Jamal Harrison Bryant. AME born, yeah. AME bred, but he is pastoring Greater New Birth Missionary Baptist Church in Lithonia, Georgia.
See, but you know what, though, Doc? Kojic Baptist Pentecostal, that's all.
First Cousins.
A name. That's just a name. If you're a preacher, you're a preacher. And if you got it in you, you got it in you. So for me, I can be a Pentecostal guy. And if a Lutheran church want to have me to be the pastor, I'm going to be the pastor over the Lutheran organization, but I'm going to
do some adjusting in your preaching style.
Yeah, you might have to, change up.
Lord,
please be there, Father.
Beach was talking about how he had, I guess it must have been a bunch of Pentecostals, so I guess, I don't know if Pentecostals have different hoops.
No.
They don't go to the cross as often as Baptist preachers.
Yeah.
Because we had to cross every Sunday.
Listen.
But I'm with you, man. And I think what you're saying now, more and more people are getting away from denominational brands.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you see a lot of churches don't even put the denomination up on the marquee now. And that's good. I mean, I'm a Baptist, and I can tell you about Baptist doctrine, why I'm a Baptist, because I was born a Baptist.
Right.
But I'm really ecumenical, man. And when it comes to preaching,
yeah,
I've heard great preachers, as you just said, they go beyond any kind of denominational affiliation. There's some guys you go in, the late G.E. Patterson.
Oh, come on, Doc.
Regularly
yes,
had Frank Ray
come
at
on.
His
yep,
church.
Sure did.
You know,
sure
so. Did. And I know he went to preach for Frank Ray.
Yeah.
But I think that, and maybe when you look at America now where church affiliation, denominational affiliation among Christians is down. As a matter of fact, the largest group in the country.
Yeah,
is the unaffiliated.
Yeah, I mean, and to be honest with you, and I was telling somebody this other day, we had this conversation. You have to be very, very, very careful with the whole denominational thing because it draws division if you don't be careful. Because then it would plant
that's what the word means.
The Baptist against Kojic against Baptist and Pentecostal against everybody else and Lutheran against. So if we're all worshiping and serving the same God, that's putting a division into the body of Christ.
The word denomination means to do what?
Divide. So you have to be very, 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 very careful with that, because, you know, that you're taking away the whole purpose of what religion really is. And it's like you putting a division in. Well, you're not good because you such and such, and you're not saved because you Baptist, and that whole garbage thing.
Man, I nickel for every time somebody, when we were kids, coaches tell me, y'all ain't saved.
Yeah.
You ain't either. Yeah. We all struggling, man, you know?
So we all sin.
Right, right. The joke is that, you know, Baptists smoke on the parking lot, Pentecostals smoke at home.
Man.
Still smoking.
But they still smoke.
Still smoke.
Same difference.
Like God stopped at the parking lot,
come
right?
On, man.
You know, if you doing it. Great, well, great segue. No, I'm going to tell you why it's a great segue, Treasurer Cox. Did I not see you singing in the choir? I saw you Good Friday. I said, is that the treasurer? He was in the Good Friday over at Mount Zion.
Yeah, Mount Zion.
Yeah.
They didn't have too many male singers.
They did not.
So they needed a baritone.
They brought him in.
That's me. So I am super surprised at the number of people who have come up to me.
Not that I was like, hey, that's Treasurer Cox. Hey,
unexpected.
Well, so for the record, we're having a at Calvary Baptist Church.
Okay.
We're having a special recognition for our pastor. And
you're
men's,
Calvary.
Yeah, I'm a Calvary boy. Yeah, born and raised at Calvary Baptist
Church. That's my
grandmother's
church.
And we're having a big deal. Starts at 9:30, and the men's choir will be singing, and so will yours truly. So if
you
folks
could,
out
you
there
get
wanna,
Rod Stinson up there,
wanna have a good laugh and see the treasurer sing, come on down to Calvary Baptist Church.
So that voice you hear is that of our, and thank you, congratulations.
Well, thank you.
Recently reelected.
It was hard fighting the invisible man because I was unopposed.
I was kidding somebody. I said, you know, if either County Executive Crowley or Mayor Johnson lost that race. Is that an act of God?
Act of something.
Act of something.
I don't think it would be God, but
it's up, right? And then we're also joined in studio by Alderman.
Yes, sir.
Mark Chambers, congratulations, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. You know, I too was fighting that invisible
man. I know. And you know what? It's
a fight.
Probability says where you're going to win. But anything can happen, right?
Anything can happen.
Right?
Quickest way we get elected, the quickest way we can get out.
Right.
Right.
Right. So again, congratulations, both of you gentlemen. You're here this morning?
Well, you know, we have a session coming up. And we all are gonna get reinaugurated. Okay, so here I am as the OG with the new blood with me. And we're just...
Oh, he's the other Spencer, by the way.
Oh my God.
Oh, man.
Real Spencer.
As opposed to T Spencer.
As opposed to T Spencer, right?
Okay. Well, it's the cogs that makes it difference, okay? Yeah. But yeah, we're going to be starting a new session. Just for the record, before I went to the legislature, I was an inspector for the city of Milwaukee, so I've seen a bunch of people come and go, and things really have changed. We are going to start a new session with the Common Council, 15 people, 8 of them are African American. That is unprecedented. We're going to have 4 women, I think, or at least, no, we're going to have 5 women,
six.
And 4
six,
of them.
Six women. Yep.
Okay.
Dimitrievich and Zamaripa are the other two. And then we have Alderwoman-elect Charlotte Moore, Alderwoman Andrea Pratt, Alderwoman Larissa Taylor, and Alderwoman Malele A. Cox.
Mm-hmm. So I'll let the new mention about what are we going to be doing on Tuesday.
Well, you know, this is my first rodeo, you know, far as not my first swearing in, but this would be the the first one for the first full term. In addition to that, there is a new wave of leadership that's coming within the city of Milwaukee. Eight of us, the same eight African-American is eight people serving their first full term in the city. Now that is unprecedented. You know, myself and Alderman Jonathan Brostoff actually started the wave, I guess to say, where we came in on the special election in November of 2022. Subsequently, we had Alderwoman Andrea Pratt, Larissa Taylor, and Alderman Lamont Westmoreland follow up in the spring election of 2023. And now we have the other three, Alderwoman-elect Charlene Moore, Alderman-elect Peter Bergelis, and Alderman-elect DeAndre Jackson coming in. So that's eight of us. And, you know, we have the opportunity to set precedent. You know, we elect, we have the right to elect a common council president and also a city clerk. And, you know, personally, me personally, I think it's time to create some more history. You know, we have eight African-American electeds in City Hall. You know, last in 2022, when Mayor Johnson became mayor, we had the ability to elect the first Latino president and President Jose Perez. But I think now it's time to, you know, add a little more history to it and, you know, elect the first African-American woman in Alderwoman Lele A. Cox, who I know came on this, came on, you know, the radio last week and this week and ever since the election to announce her intention. And I'm 100% behind her, you know, in her quest to become the first African-American woman for Common Council President.
Yeah, and Alderman Chambers is entirely correct. This is a historical moment. So usually what happens, it happens behind closed doors with the Common Council members. Well, we want to put out there, as politicians, we want to put out there that the community should get involved, that the community should call their aldermen and say, let's make history. It's time. Okay, there are people who say that the current leadership has two of the African American members in his back pocket. Well, myself and Alderman Chambers kind of made that head count, and that's not true. But, you know, people are still being a little cagey and not saying exactly where they are. Oh, we won't know for sure until next week. So we like to, we want to open this process and tell the people of City of Milwaukee, especially Black people who are the dominant numbers here, that we can make history and that they should urge their aldermen to do that.
All right, then I will give my alder a call. That'll be Charlene Moore. So Tuesday is the official swearing in inauguration.
Yep. You know, before I go into that and go through this, you know, I've been in this role for roughly 18 months, and I gotta give, you know, Alderwoman Cox her flowers. I think I came on here during election day. I think I came on here. I think I went on 101.7 The Truth because some people were, you know, making some ill-advised comments, to say the least. And then I know it was probably from like her opponent's camp at the time that she beat, obliterated 75-25, might I add. But, you know, Alderwoman Cox was the first, has and is the youngest elected female to the Milwaukee Common Council. She was the sole survivor, the lone woman on the council for 8 years. She was there by herself for 8 years, and she tried, you know, she triumphed it. She passed over 800 pieces of legislation. She's a community advocate. She's a community warrior. She led the transformation of Bronzeville that you see right now. And, you know, she's got a lot of things to keep going. And I know we're going on break, so I'm going to let me go to it.
All right, we're joined in studio. I can, you guys are in your position. Can I say elect? You're in your position.
Yeah.
City Treasurer Spencer Coggs, Alderman Mark Chambers, you're the
second
Automatic District. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Everyone knows things happen, especially money-related situations. Maybe you need money to repair your car, or maybe you need money for a new phone. It sure is difficult if you need money and have little available. That is the purpose of an emergency fund. Money advisors suggest you have two or more times your monthly income in an emergency fund. You can determine how much you want in your emergency fund. Then you can start with a savings plan to place money aside each month to build your emergency fund. Try to keep money there. Remember, it's an emergency fund.
If you've got the right tools and the friendly people at U.S. Bank in your corner, making smarter money choices is a piece of cake. If only our tools and helpful advisors could have helped you avoid some of those not-so-smart choices in life. Like that time you tried to pick up unicycling.
Whoa, coming through!
Or when you thought it'd be okay to pet that squirrel in the park.
Good squirrel.
While we can't help you with all that, we can help you bank smartly at usbank.com/smartertogether. Member FDIC.
Milwaukee, this is Michelle Bryant, your host of Say Something Real. When President Joe Biden wanted to talk to Milwaukee voters, he called WNOV.
And welcome President Biden to Milwaukee and to WNOV. How you doing today, sir?
I'm doing well. Had a great event downtown, and I'm at the headquarters now, and we're feeling really good. A great day. We have a thousand volunteers going out here in Wisconsin, out of Milwaukee in particular.
So we are ready to roll in Wisconsin.
Well, I tell you what, God love you.
For up-to-date election information, keep it locked on WNOV 860 AM 106.5 FM.
Great impressions will exceed your expectations. Great impressions, perceptions, everything.
Looking to leave a lasting impression? Look no further than Great Impressions Graphics and Printing. With over 25 years of experience, we're your one-stop shop for all things printing. Whether it's custom invitations, banners, apparel, or high-quality on-time funeral programs, we've got you covered. Planning a family reunion? We'd love to help. Visit our website at greatimpress.com or give us a call at 414-536-7646 to start your next project today. We're here when you need us.
Great Impressions.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Community Voice on WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM.
All right, welcome back. And again, we're in studio with City of Milwaukee Treasurer Spencer Coggs, the Spencer Coggs, and Alderman Mark Chambers, the second Automatic District.
Oh, man.
I don't remember. I you're a pro at this. And Mark, your background, you know, so nothing should surprise you in politics.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Nothing should surprise you. If you think, oh, it should be going this way and then it'll go a different way, don't be surprised. It's just how, you know, that's how the sausage is made. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm not frustrated. I just think this idea that, and Michelle went in length on this, this idea that our perceptions of people on how they look, right? Mm-hmm. And one of the, you know, basics is, are they male or female? And so more than qualified. So I think people have to make the decision, but you all know there's politics there too.
Yeah.
Yeah, there are politics there, but let's not ignore the facts. And the facts are that, you know, Malele Cox has done things that others couldn't do. Okay, we now have a Bell Phillips Boulevard because of Malele Cox. Alderman Chambers mentioned Bronzeville. That is beautiful.
King Drive.
Dr. And William Finlayson.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, the Martin Luther King. Now, that to me, that's an interesting one because we tried to get Martin Luther King Boulevard. We got it, but they wouldn't let it extend all the
downtown,
way
right.
to Wisconsin Avenue. And Lele got it done. And that was hard because the businesses always wanted it to be Old World Third Street.
Well, and I think it's also the perception that if you go to any other city in the country and you see Martin Luther King Boulevard, Street, Drive, it's usually in economically depressed areas. To see our King Drive and the expansion, so downtown wasn't going to hurt their brand. The original fear, mm-hmm. remember, was it was going to hurt their brand, yep. right? And but with all the development that you have, and then, of course, on the backside of them is Bell Phillips. I think.
And then after that, you got Dr. William Finlayson, who, you know, Alderwoman Cox, in partnership with Alderman Russell Stamper, were able to have this street named after him while he's still living.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And not only that, you know, now, you know, with Alderwoman Cox, Alderman Khalif Rainey, and Alderman Russell Stamper, Dr. Lester Carter is about to have his street put up in a couple of weeks on 24th Street from Keefe all the way to Walnut. So, you know, those Black pioneers, those history makers, you know, paved the way for people like myself, people like, you know, Alderman Lamont Westmoreland, people like Alderman-elect DeAndre Jackson can have a baseline on try to strive for, you know, our personal greatness. And I believe that it is those history makers and those that came before us and those that are with us now, that can help, you know, mold us in that path.
I just realized this. You're his uncle. And the reason I said that is we should be doing, I'll go out here, we should be doing a Lula Mae Chambers. We really, folks,
in the works.
Yes, thank you. Long overdue.
You mentioned Lula Mae Chambers and you're Alderman Chambers, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So that's a direct line.
Yeah.
Right there. Okay. Yeah. And you know, yeah. as the OG
are you embracing OG-ness?
Might as well.
You're embracing it? Because a lot of us be running, what up, triple OG? Like, dude, I ain't no OG.
Yeah,
my Kangles and Stacey Adams.
Yeah, you're wearing them, but I have others on.
I got Stacey Adams on right
you
now.
You got the Stacey's on there. The old school.
That's what happened to me. You know, at one point, I was talking to some students, and they were, you know, and they were into me, and everything was fine. And then they came up to me and said, hey, old school. And I was like, oh. It's like calling me sir. You know.
Well, let me ask you, can I ask a technical how this should happen?
Yeah.
The inauguration is Tuesday?
Yeah, so we have the charter meeting. So it's two separate meetings.
Okay.
So we have our charter meeting that happens once every 4 years or once or should. I think we have other ways to establish a charter meeting, but the charter meeting normally happens once every 4 years. That charter meeting will be at 9 a.m. Okay. That is at the time where we officially get sworn in. And then we get to business, whether that's electing our common council president, and then we elect our city clerk. Then from there, I get my give a whole rundown of Tuesday. So from there, we handle that business, and then we adjourn for that particular moment, or we stay in committee, I should say. And then Mayor Johnson is getting sworn in downstairs in the City Hall Rotunda at 10. And then following up from there at 10:30, we're going back upstairs to the Common Council chambers where Treasurer Cox, Comptroller-elect Bill Christensen, City Attorney-elect Evan Goyke, and us will be sworn in again, where we have our pomps and circumstance, where we have our speeches, so on and so forth. But it's at that time the new president will be presiding at the top.
And this is why I was asking questions. So for a person like me, who's in a district where I'm getting a new alderman.
Yep.
And so at this point,
Alderwoman,
I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. So how do, if I want to contact them,
I would say if you have a new alder person that is coming in, I would say reach out to their campaign page.
Okay.
I would say reach out to their campaign contact, because at the end of the day, until the 16th, until they're sworn in, they're not their alder person to elect.
Exactly.
But, you know, I'm pretty sure I know DeAndre Jackson has a social media. I know Peter Bergelis has social media. I know Charlotte Moore has social media as well. So I would say reach out to their respective campaign, email address, phone number, so on and so forth.
And for those who are currently in office, you can call the general number, which is 414-286-2221, and then they'll connect you to that office.
Here's a couple of calls. No,
go on. I was going to say, or you can go to milwaukee.gov/commonCouncil, and you can go right to your respective alder person's names and click on their picture, and their contact information will be right under there as well.
All right, caller, a couple quick calls. Caller, welcome to the program.
Good morning, and thank you for taking the call. To Keith and Keon and Carvey, and to your guests, Spencer Cox and Mark Chambers. I just want to chime in and say, without a doubt, Malele Cox is more than qualified. And when you talk about her and it's a history making thing, please, I believe she is the, I don't know, grammatically correct. She is highly educated. And I think you should bring in all that she brings to the table, along with her experience and along with all of the achievements that she have accomplished. And you don't have to worry about anybody else that's running. Just talk about the good and the fact that she will be a fair person. She's going to be looking at all things that's going to be good for the outcome of Milwaukee, for the other aldermen, not just looking at what's going to be one-sided. No, she's going to be there for the good of all. I've been down there for various reasons to testify for in the Monty United area, trying to get rid of businesses that were not conducive to the area. And I like the all overall thing that takes place. And so I'm praying that think the outcome is what it should be. And thank you for taking my call. I just want to mention another thing, and that's about this abortion and young people making choices and about buying homes. It's a lot of them want to buy a home in some of these places where they have Republican governors. And they're thinking of moving because of the foolishness that's going on with the abortion. So when you're talking about laying down roots, people are making decisions based on a lot of things that they never used to have to make them on. Thank you for taking my call.
All right.
Well, thank you. And please call it, call your alder person and tell them what you just said to us. Because you're absolutely correct. Malele Cox, not you know, experience notwithstanding, she is a proud MBS graduate from Riverside. She went to Fisk University, then she came back to Wisconsin and got her law degree from UW. So she's Wisconsin, you know, true and true. And she doesn't brag on herself. And obviously, I'm prejudiced because I'm her uncle. But her record and her experience and her commitment to the community, like Alderman Chambers, they have regular meetings in the community in their district, okay, so they can get the pulse of the people they represent.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Caller, welcome to the program.
Good morning, Keith, and to your guests.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to step on some toes. I'm not talking about like the businesses or like the private homes where a lot of campaign signs were put out, but there were tons and tons of campaign signs illegally placed all over the city, all up and down the medians near freeway entrances or whatever. So since the election is over, who goes and picks up all that stuff that wasn't supposed to be there in the first place? Because now it's considered litter.
Right. And they have 30 days, right?
Well, if there are in illegal places, what you should do is contact the Department of Public Works. So there are in like medians or anything, and the Department of Public Works will get them up right away. Yes, they do have 30 days after the election to have those removed what we were removing for.
Okay, and then but why should the city be responsible when whoever worked for that campaign put those signs out? Why shouldn't they just go and pick them back up?
I mean, I think Alderman Chambers is right, and I think you have a point. I also, as a public elected official, who always put my signs where they were supposed to, when I see people who do it wrong way, it upsets me because it tells the public that, you know, candidates aren't doing the right thing. So you should contact the candidate's office or contact person and tell them they should pick up what they put down.
Right. I'll call David Crotty's office. I'll hang up.
Oh, man.
My mama say some folks can't do wrong right. Some folks can't do wrong right. You know, it's just like, oh, I'm actually with David Board, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So again, all this happens on Tuesday. We appreciate you all coming in. Again, if you're in support of Alderwoman Malele Coggs being the next Common Council president, you need to call your representative to let them know. Let them know what you think.
At the end of the day, we want people to practice their right to democracy. And, you know, we have a great chance. Milwaukee is a minority majority city. We are slowly but surely coming to, the look of a minority majority city. And, you know, it's time to, you know, exercise our voice to have them heard. You know, if you want more people to come have block watch meetings or block walks or, you know, town halls, please contact the office. Not necessarily just only for this particular vote, as vital as it is, but contact the office and get some things going, especially cleanup. Now the winter is gone and I'm seeing a lot of trash around here. Mm-hmm. Best believe we are here ready to serve you and get some things going to make our community better and our city better. And thank
it's
you
about so accountability.
Always. And you got to hold people to hold their feet to the fire.
Yes, sir.
Milwaukee City Treasurer, Spencer Coggs, Milwaukee Alderman, Mark Chambers of the 2nd Automatic District. Thank you all for coming in.
Thank you, sir.
Appreciate it. And again, congratulations on your re-elections.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a real quick break, get our next guest in. We'll be right back. Thank you. All right, welcome back to Community Voice, and it's that time of year.
Yes, it is.
All right, we're joined in the studio by Mr. Manuel Kirkendall. He's the CEO, right?
COO
of Community Advocates, and we're here to talk about the moratorium ending on Monday, the shutoffs, and people can take advantage of energy assistance.
So. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It is that time of year again. We are encouraging individuals to come down and apply for energy assistance again. Again, it's relatively simple nowadays, so it's not the olden days where you wait in line for an hour, two, or three, maybe, and maybe not get seen. You can call in. We can do everything over the phone, so you do not actually have to take off work, you know, step away from your home, a 15 to 20 minute application, and we will provide you with that one-time benefit.
And because it's been such a mild spring, mm-hmm. I think they're going to be out there on the 5th or the 16th. So I don't know if people heard about the young man that died in the fire, the little kid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what it was they were using the stove to heat the house.
Right.
Right. So it sounds like they had, you know, no electricity or no heat in the house. And so they were using the stove. So, you know, we don't want people to put themselves in dangerous. The reason why we had the moratorium was, I think a few years back, there was a family that actually had been cut off and all the
Yeah, we had a couple of situations. There was an individual that froze to death
in the house.
Yeah, because of lack of heat. So, yeah.
So for people who are at risk of their energy being cut off,
mm-hmm.
is that emergency assistance or?
That is, we can do a couple of things, actually. And I just want to say the program is administered by Department of Administration in the state of Wisconsin, and it flows through Milwaukee County, DHHS. And they support Community Advocates, UMOs, with the energy assistance program. Yeah, so right now it's generally just energy assistance. However, if individuals are in need of some additional support, we do have a one-time additional payment that we can make in addition to that energy assistance for crisis assistance. And so, again, depending on the situation, we're averaging the benefit about $400 to up to maybe $700 for that benefit. And again, generally the restoration for energy services is about $600. So.
And then what happens? They work something out with you that then they can take to We Energies in order to get, if they've been shut off, to get their utilities reconnected?
Yeah, we make it very simple now. I mean, once they come in and apply for the benefit and we complete the application, we actually send We Energies a notification that they've applied and there's a promise to pay and the money will be coming usually like by the following Wednesday. And so customers generally just have to call and get set up on a payment arrangement.
What's the average grant?
Right now, between $350 to about $450. But again, there's that additional crisis assistance that we will be able to give out. And that could be additional $300 or more, depending on the situation.
What do I need to, in terms of verification information?
If you're in the system already, so you applied already, we really just need your income for the previous month.
Okay.
And it's that simple. I mean, before we needed 3 months of additional income information, ID, social security numbers. We don't need any of that anymore. If you've applied, we really just need your income information. We can look up your usage and things of that nature to make the process really simple.
You know, one of the things you would mention when you come in was the total number of people who did not take advantage.
Yeah.
Is that still a large number?
That is still a large number. I mean, we're estimating, you know, 40 to 60,000 households that may not be applying that could be eligible. And this is just based upon the number of people that receive food share.
How quickly, if I came in and applied today, how quickly would that be processed or normal and I could expect a payment?
Same day. If you come in with all your information, we process and close the application within that 20-minute time period and send that notification to We Energies. Now, if you come in and you're missing something, maybe you're missing your check stub from the prior month, we do have to wait for that information to come in. And again, generally, we're processing that within 48 business hours. So it's a really quick turnaround. So, now, things may change because, again, as the moratorium starts and ends, rather, we have more people coming in. And this is why we're encouraging people to come in now. There is no wait. There is no long line. You can get an appointment actually probably tomorrow if you apply today, if you went in and look for the appointment.
So do you need an appointment?
We do ask that you have an appointment, again, just so that we are getting people in and out. So we don't want people waiting. You can come down if you want, and we will see you as a walk-in in some instances. But, again, that wait could be long.
How long does this particular season last for energy assistance?
So, you know, people always think that this is a 9-month program. Energy assistance is year round.
Okay.
And so, you know, we're doing weatherization year round. We're providing crisis assistance during certain periods of the time, but energy assistance is a year round benefit. This date actually, generally what happens is May 15th is the cutoff date for energy assistance, but we continue to process crisis applications during the summer months. I mean, the state has been very lenient and allowed us to process even during the summer months. And primarily since COVID occurred, and it kind of changed and been a lot more flexible. So again, I would not guarantee that it's going to happen this year again. So I tell people to come in before May 15th.
So it sounds like the money could be gone after May 15th?
Well, no, the money
is still there.
The energy assistance funding we will no longer be able to process your energy application, but the crisis assistance generally will be there.
That's year round.
Year round, yeah.
Does it matter if I'm a renter?
It does not. I mean, it's income based. So if you're a homeowner or a renter, you can apply for energy assistance and all the other services that come along with it. One of the new things that's supposed to happen soon is, and I think you've talked about this in the past, there was funding for a central air conditioning unit. Cooling. Yeah. The state has actually started the process of training and talking about that being done this summer. So it'll be an additional benefit. However, you have to apply for energy assistance to get that benefit.
Yeah, and that was fascinating because I remember, and this is, man, years ago, we had 95. Where we had this incredible heat wave. And for the first time, I think SDC then had it. Mm-hmm. And so they were giving people fans and air conditioners, right? We couldn't find any air conditioners because we had a heat wave, they sold out. So yeah, I mean that when you think about energy, we always think about heat, mm-hmm. but cooling is, and probably in southern states, that's probably more what you're looking, but even here we have that available.
Yeah, definitely.
And one thing we talked about when we talked about the weatherization program is that usually if you're eligible for energy assistance, you're already in the system, you can be looked at then for the weatherization.
Exactly, yes.
So there's been, and you said once in the system, so if I applied last year and was eligible, haven't had any change in circumstances, I'm already in the system. What is that, renewal or?
All it is you come in and provide your monthly income, the prior month's income, and we can get you processed.
How long does that, I'm using terminology, I'm coming. How long does that case stay active in terms of you being able to?
Well, it's every season. So, every season you can reapply.
Okay. Phone numbers if people want to.
Sure. Yep. If you're interested in applying, you can call 414-270-4653. That's also 414-270-4MKE.
And that would be for both locations, or you?
That would be for all locations.
Yep. All locations.
So we have a centralized call center that will take the call and schedule an appointment at one of the locations. And the process will be the same for both locations, all locations rather.
Excellent. Website?
Yep. So the website is, you can go to Milwaukee County's website, you can go to communityadvocates.net, and just put the search in for energy assistance, and all the information will come up, the flyers, the income guidelines, and all that would be there.
It's that time of year.
It is that time of year.
Let me thank Mr. Mawella Kirkendall, Community Advocates. He's the CEO there, and we're talking about energy assistance. Again, that number and the website?
414-270-4MKE. And you can also go to Milwaukee County's Energy Assistance website, Community Advocates Energy Assistance website, or UMOSIS Energy Assistance website.
Appreciate you, man. I know you kind of got this last minute, but appreciate you making yourself available.
Anytime.
All right. You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back.
The Milwaukee Public Library Foundation is a supporting force behind the incredible programs at our libraries. The Milwaukee Public Library Foundation engages foundations, corporations, and generous donors to support 90% of the 6,000 programs hosted in Milwaukee's 13 neighborhood branches. Whether you're into reading, technology, or just hanging out with friends, the foundation makes sure everyone has access to amazing books, cool workshops, and awesome programs.
Did you know that the Milwaukee Public Library allows patrons to check out Chromebooks and Wi-Fi hotspots? Empowering individuals to access essential online resources and services from anywhere.
Milwaukee Film's Black Brains program aims to foster meaningful community conversations, promote celebration, and strengthen community bonds within and beyond the cinematic setting. Black Lens was created with a singular focus to spotlight the incredible work of filmmakers of African descent by bringing their films to the Milwaukee Film Festival. These filmmakers explore the stories, the topics, and the histories that are deeply shared throughout the Black diaspora while inviting diverse audience engagement. Now celebrating this commemorative 10th year, the Black Lens program has evolved beyond the festival, offering year-round film programming. This promises even more unique cinematic experiences, honoring the rich legacy of Black film while championing the contemporary wave of Black filmmakers. For more information on the Black Lens program, go to mkefilm.org.
Looking for the perfect spot to unwind and hang out with your friends? Well, come visit Brownstone Social Lounge, located at 524 North Water Street, Milwaukee's premier downtown social lounge. For good vibes, great music, and delicious food, be sure to try our amazing wings and drink specials during our all-day happy hour on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. And that's not all. You can also enjoy happy hour from Thursday to Sunday from 4 p.m. until 7 p.m. For more information, please call 414-204-0103. Brownstone Social Lounge.
The Wisconsin Home Energy Assistance Program end of the season is approaching. Don't miss out on benefits and help with your WEED energy bill. Just go to keepwarmmke.org. It's made it easy for you to schedule an appointment. You may also call 414-270-4653. Don't delay. Call us today. Again, that's 414-270-4653. Or visit us online at keepwarmmke.org. This is administered by the State of Wisconsin Home Energy Plus Program.
Hey, oh, what it do? This is Quavana Anton Nixon. Catch me Tuesdays through Fridays on WNOV 860 from 3 to 5 p.m. with culture, community, and conversations. Pull up, you on the porch with Quav. That's Tuesday through Friday from 3 to 5 p.m. on the new 860 WNOV and 106.5.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Inside Community Voice on WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM with your host, Keith Paris.
All right, welcome back to Community Voice. And we just got the news that O.J. Simpson has made his transition, 76 years old. So I guess we'll never know.
Oh, man. Oh, my God.
Is it too soon? Guess we'll never know.
If it don't fit,
he must have quit.
Hey, man. Wow. 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 So we'll never know, huh?
We'll never know. Oh. But let me, I was telling Jay, I was like, but he could run.
Oh, man.
If he was the quality individual he was as a football player, but no, he could, man, if you ever saw O.J. Simpson run, it was just something, man. He was an incredible, incredible running back.
Yeah, excellent athlete.
But wow, so yeah, 77. I know he had been dealing with cancer.
Really?
And yeah, so he succumbed to cancer. So we won't know. I guess it goes to a grave with him, huh?
Well,
unless he wrote a note.
Listen here, man.
Unless he wrote a note.
Man,
yeah. All right.
I'm not touching that one.
We're joined in studio by Mr. Theo Liskum. Lisk, Milwaukee Executive Director. Always do this. So what is that acronym? What does Lisk stand for? I always call it Lisk, Lift. I kill it.
Use Lisk. It's just a little easier. But it's Local Initiatives Support Corporation. So we're a national nonprofit. We're the largest nonprofit community development financial institution.
So what's the mission of LISC?
Yeah, so we invest in community development. We invest primarily in affordable housing, but also in commercial revitalization, community facilities, schools, safety programs, and you know, along with investing in those, we also build capacity. So that's the local part of that, is that our work, my team in Milwaukee, is helping to build the capacity of organizations and emerging developers here in Milwaukee who can to give them the skills and the knowledge to be able to access the kinds of community development resources that are out there, whether that's tax credit programs, whether that's loans, grants, other things for them to build the project.
You are almost like the quiet organization.
Well, if we're doing our job right, we shouldn't be the spotlight, right?
Okay.
So we are behind the projects. We aren't building anything. We aren't owning anything. Our partners are doing that, whether those are nonprofits or emerging developers. They're building these projects. They're taking the risk. We're participating. We're loaning them money. Sometimes we're putting up early grant funds into projects. But really, we're helping to facilitate that. And so we shouldn't be the lead story. But we are powering a lot of this work behind the scenes. So some people may know the work we're doing and not know us. So they may know Brew City Match, which is our small business investment in six targeted corridors. They may know our work in affordable housing. They may know the ACRE program, the Associates in Commercial Real Estate, which has been very impactful in Milwaukee, and not know that we're the engine behind that.
We're joined on the phone by Deion Grayson. Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay. How are you?
I am wonderful. How are you?
I'm doing well. And Ms. Grayson is the Mandy Selection Oversight Coordinator. What is Mandy?
What is Mandy?
Not Mandy, just one of my very favorite Barry Manilow songs, but what is Mandy? Sorry about that geek moment. I'm sorry. What is Mandy?
What is the Mandy Award? So uh-huh. The Mandy Award, it's a way for us to really recognize all that is good that is taking place in Milwaukee. It's a wonderful celebration of what is taking place in Milwaukee neighborhoods with individuals, nonprofit organizations, and small businesses.
Now, is Mandy an acronym for something or?
Yes.
Yes, Mandy is. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry, Dan. I didn't mean to cut you off. It's M-A-N-D-I is the Milwaukee Awards for Neighborhood Development Innovation.
Mandy.
And I just want to recognize Dion. Thank you for joining us this morning, because Dion is so instrumental in making sure that the process of nominations for the awards, the selection committee, managing the volunteers, and making sure that there is integrity behind the selection, that all happens. And so I'm dependent on her, and I just want to recognize her work for many years now.
Real quick, behind the Mandy's. And it kind of ties into this. How old is LISC as an organization?
How old? We're over 40 years.
Over 40 years. And so but LISC has been doing the Mandy's.
Been in Milwaukee. We've been in Milwaukee since 95, and we've been doing the Mandy's for 25 years. So okay. this is a really important anniversary year for us. And looking forward to it being even bigger and better.
What would be the criteria in terms of nominations? Who are you looking for in terms of nominees for this award?
So we have several categories that people can apply for. If you don't mind, I can just run through each of the categories and tell what we're looking for. Mm-hmm. We have a new category that is sponsored by the Medical College of Wisconsin. It's called Advancing a Healthier Wisconsin Endowment Community Health Award. And this category really acknowledges organizations working to eliminate health disparities through system change. Last year, we had 16th Street Community Health Centers. They were the winner. And I thought that was a great way to start out the inception of the award because of all that the 16th Street Community Health Centers has done for our city over the past years. We also have the Associated Bank Trailblazer Award. And this award really honors innovative approaches to problem solving that is producing demonstrative results. And so this is often a very competitive category this year. We have so many wonderful individuals and organizations in the community that are blazing trails in Milwaukee. And last year, the Ability Center, they won the award for the work that they're going to be doing in parks around making sure that there's accessibility for all individuals. The Cornerstone Award, that's sponsored by BMO. This one honors an organization or a program that has longstanding commitment to neighborhood and demonstrative effectiveness over time. So these are your pillar nonprofit organizations that have been around for a long time and are truly making impact in the community, like Axe Housing. They were our winner last year. And then we have the Brewers Community Foundation Public Space Award. And this honors the use of public space that contributes to the overall well-being of the community. And so last year we had the Burnham Park Playfield renovation. So these are your outdoor spaces that are really making impact in the city. Those individuals who have projects that are doing that, they should apply in that category. And then we have the J.P. Chase Economic Development Award. This honors outstanding programs that stimulate economic and business development on a neighborhood scale. Now, this award can be a nonprofit organization, or it could be a small business. It can be a small business that is really making impact and stimulating things economically. Last year, Upstart Kitchen was the winner of that award. Two more awards to go. We have the Hush Blackwell Building Blocks Award. This is where we honor real estate projects that contribute significantly to the enhancement of our community. So with this award, we're not just looking at the infrastructure. That is mainly what the award is about, but we're looking at the impact that infrastructure has in the community. And last year, Westlawn Renaissance was the winner of that award. And then finally, we have the Navigator Award, and this honors an individual that is demonstrating leadership and collaboration for change. And so we're looking for individuals who are moving the needle around an issue in Milwaukee. Last year, our winner was Coretta Herring. And if you know Coretta, she has really made a tremendous impact in the city of Milwaukee around financial literacy, not just in her work, but in her family. That was very demonstrated in her site visit, that those who she's involved in is her family and her neighborhood and the community center that she grew up in. She made sure that they were financially literate. So those are, oh, go ahead.
No. I was going to ask a question. So does these awards come with grants or?
There's a $1,000. Okay. Cash prize, but the bigger thing is the honor and the recognition you're getting in the community. We do produce a video for each of them, so many, if particularly for the organizations, many of them use that to also do additional promotion and awareness around their project.
We're coming up on the application deadline for people who want to do nominations. That is next Thursday.
It is April 18th, and that would be at mandyawards.com. So M-A-N-D-I awards.com.
Now, is there a committee that once the nominations are received will review that and then a decision is made?
Yes, we have 33 individuals from the committee who are part of the selection committee this year. What happens first is once the applications are submitted, we have reviewers. Each reviewer reviews three categories that they're experts in. And once they review those categories, they have 5 days to review those categories. And then the top five in each category emerge. Then we have a group of jurors, and the jurors, they review all of the categories. They review the top five in each category. And then they come in person for a meeting to select the top two in each category. Once the top two are selected, the selection committee goes out and they do site visits for a full week. Every site is visited. And then after the site visit, the jurors sit down, and then we have a special committee, a real estate jury committee that does the building blocks award, and then they make the final decision.
Is there a, so is there an event where, you know, people, the awards are given?
Yeah. So the actual awards event is in August. So this year it's August 15th. It's a Thursday evening, and we'll be at the new addition to the Baird Center, the convention center. So we'll be one of the first events in the new space. So we're really looking forward to that for our 25th year.
Now, is that a ticketed event?
That is a ticketed event. I don't have amounts on us, but that you can also get through the web. You will be able to get through the website closer to the event. Individual tickets are available, but also if there are businesses or organizations that want to sponsor a table, we have table sales and other sponsorship opportunities.
This is a kind of rhetorical softball question. Why is this important in terms of the recognition?
Yeah, I just think that these organizations or these programs are underappreciated or underrecognized, and it's just an opportunity to have a night of positive recognition of the work that so many people are doing in our community to make change. I think this year is going to be pretty impressive in that we'll be able to sort of look at the legacy of what this has been over 25 years and some of the those who've been recognized in the past. But I think too often we're focused on the problems and not on those who are actually making impact. And so this is a time out each year to do that.
Go ahead. Yeah, I'm sorry.
No, I just wanted to add to that really quickly is that you think you know Milwaukee. Right. We've been here for a long time and doing a lot of work in our respective spaces. But every year there are nominations that come through that no one knew anything about. Mm-hmm. And there are people who are doing absolutely wonderful things that people don't know about. So it is really wonderful to be able to uplift those individuals and those organizations to give them a platform through this process.
Do you think it's important that you just said that a lot of times we might have a certain low self-esteem when it comes to a city because we're not aware of a lot of the good work that's going on in the community?
Yeah, I think even for those of us who are working in community development, we sometimes, you know, you get down on the, you're realizing all the challenges, and it's important to learn about others who are working in the space. Like, as Dion said, I'm regularly surprised. I think I'm well-connected, and then I learn about somebody doing something fantastic that I didn't even know about.
So the issue right now, housing, and just how critical housing is, and I heard something here about Milwaukee has the second hottest rental market in the country, you know, in terms of people and the demands for rental properties, those type. So what when we're looking at development, are we talking residential development? Are we talking business development? You know, you were talking about uses of spaces. One of the spaces that I thought about was Alice Gardens, for example. So.
Yeah, so they're of the seven award categories, they're all different, and there are categories that do all of those things. So there's the real estate project, there's the public space, there's the economic development program. You know, so there are among the seven categories, I think people can find an appropriate place to nominate the project, the person, the organization that they're working with, and. And I just want to encourage people if they, you know, you can self-nominate. And in fact, that in some cases is easier because you know the work, you know the things about the work that you're doing that you can put those details in. So I don't want anybody to be shy about self-nominating. No one else will know who nominated. That again is what I was trying to recognize about Dion's work and the work of the volunteers. Is that this is just such a high integrity process, right? So this is not Theo's list of who I want to give awards to. These are not the partners we're working with. We're not awarding our funders. This is a legitimate, very objective process to recognize people, whether or not they have any connection to LISC or to our sponsors or any of that. So.
Dion, I think before you joined the call, Theo had said that he was surprised. Are you surprised by what you see in terms of breadth and scope of the work that folks are doing in the community that kind of goes under the radar?
I don't know if surprise is the word. Well, I guess it's refreshing, I would say. I think that, you know, a lot of us have been doing the work that we do in the community for such a long time. And I think you get caught up in your own bubble, right? And so I think it's really refreshing to learn about some of the work that other people are doing in the community. I think of one project that was really impactful on the selection committee years ago is Just One More Ministry. And they're a nonprofit organization that was founded by a gentleman who really had a hard time with some things in his past. And what he did was he's partnered with different restaurants in the community that at the end of the day, the food that's left over, he goes to get the food from these different restaurants. They have a very large freezer that was paid by Impact 100. They got a grant from Impact 100. And what they do is they go around and they feed the elderly, they feed veterans. And so that was something that most people on the selection committee had no idea about. And when the process was over, they could not wait to reach back out to them to be a resource. So it's very refreshing to learn about the wonderful ways people are doing things in their niche to help move forward things in Milwaukee.
Yes, you know, it's interesting because I drive and I drive. First of all, I don't really appreciate how big Milwaukee is in terms of a space, right? You don't, because I just seem to be, not say cloistered, but where I'm going. So when I get out sometimes out of my little comfort space and I go like, wow, or you drive by something, you see a development and you didn't even know that development was there, you know? So,
right.
Yeah. It's amazing when you think about the city and then just how big and how vast and how diverse the city is. I think, every day I listen to the complaints, right?
Sure.
And you realize that's your area, but the city is really bigger, and there's a lot of good things happening in Milwaukee, especially when we're talking about trying to meet the needs of underserved communities.
Absolutely. So here's the opportunity for people to tell those stories to a wider audience. If they're doing that work, or if they're aware of that work, please, you know, nominate. Again, it's Mandy, M-A-N-D-I, awards.com. And we've got another week left for those nominations.
And if I could.
Sure, you sure can.
Yeah, if I can just add two things to that. Two things I want to say. With public space, I want people to think outside of the box what a public space is. Like there was a couple of years ago, the Black Holocaust Museum, they won the award for public space. Mm-hmm. And so I think that you submit a nomination based on what you see, and then put it up for consideration with the selection committee. I also want to say too, with the Navigator Award, I think that that opened yourselves up to who was nominated for the award. There is a lot of people who are younger who are really blazing trails in Milwaukee. It doesn't necessarily have to be someone who is a little bit older. There are people in their 30s and 40s that are blazing trails. So if you know individuals that are really moving the needle around the issue and they're younger, nominate them for the Navigator Award.
And the benefit of that is then for people who are probably in that particular demographic that you just identified, that, you know, they can see that, hey, people are paying attention.
Right.
Dion.
Yeah.
You're from Milwaukee?
Yes, I am. I consider myself homegrown, elementary, middle, high school, undergrad, and graduate school. Okay. Yes.
Well, shout out to high school. See if I can hate on the high
school. Milwaukee Tech Trojans.
Oh, yeah.
You got the best spirit in the city. Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yes.
Okay. Your college alma mater?
I went to Alverno College for undergrad.
Okay.
Absolutely loved the experience. And I went to UWM for graduate school.
No, I'm a real Alverno pioneered this people continuing education, primarily women, and allowed folks who, you know, women who had families to be able to go back to school or go to school and get their degrees. Mm-hmm. So I just love the mission of Alverno. Yeah.
I do too. It was a very, very rich experience. And during my time there, I really learned a lot about myself, and I feel like that's really where I got my voice. I got my voice when I was at Alverno. So I really recommend the college, and I really love the experience.
I appreciate that. And man, the Trojans.
Yes.
So was it Bradley?
Don't sleep
on it. I'm not going to put your age on. Was it Bradley when you were there? Was it before?
No, I went to, listen, I'm very proud. I went to Milwaukee Trade and Technical High School. That's where I went to school.
and for the women who were the pioneers there, let me shout out those women who got there and got to Tech. I was not smart enough to get into Tech. I was not smart enough to get into Tech, because back in the day, you actually had to do a math aptitude test to get into Tech, and it wasn't even happening. It wasn't even happening. But the women who I went out, Mabel Lamb and folks like that I knew who were out there, I mean, that had to be real different.
Going to Tech?
Yeah.
It was rich, I feel like. It was, and so I even look at, you know, my life today is, that we know, my husband is involved in real estate, and we know so many contractors, you know, based on the work that everyone was doing in their respective careers at Tech. So it was, and we, you know, Tech is a very celebratory school. We get together annually, so I'm really grateful that I went to that school as well.
All right. You're listening to Community Voice. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
This is a special alert to all Americans who own a vehicle with less than 200,000 miles, with an auto warranty about to expire, or with no warranty coverage at all. Due to a decline in the economy, CarShield is announcing a low-cost, month-to-month vehicle protection plan that is now available to the public to save any driver out-of-pocket expenses on future auto repairs. Call now to find out how you can pay almost nothing for covered auto repairs. Yes, you heard that correctly. Pay almost nothing for covered auto repairs. An open phone line has been established for all drivers to call for a free, quick quote. Call 800-677-5964 now. Drivers who are covered will not have to pay for covered repairs again. This protection plan is at an all-time low. Additionally, drivers who activate this vehicle protection today will also receive free roadside assistance, free towing, and car rental options at no additional cost. Call us for your free quick quote today. 800-677-5964. That's 800-677-5964. What do you have to lose? Call 800-677-5964. Again, 800-677-5964.
Hello, I'm Vanessa, co-chair of the Juneteenth Vendors.
I am Frank, co-chair of the Juneteenth Volunteers.
Juneteenth is fastly approaching and space is always limited. So if you have an interest in being a vendor, you need to sign up today.
Juneteenth would not be successful unless we have volunteers. We need volunteers for a multitude of different areas. So companies, corporations, organizations, Divine Nine, even families, please sign up to be volunteers today.
So call Northcott Neighborhood House today at 414-372-3770.
Vendors and volunteers call today at 414-372-3770.
Thank you.
Prom is here and graduation is near. Stop by Nicovani's, where they have a large variety of suits, blazers, and shoes to get you right for that special day. You already know Nicovani has the $100 hookup. You can get a suit, shirt, tie, and shoes, all for just $100. Nicovani's, open 7 days a week, with an on-site tailor. Nicovani's on the second floor of the Mayfair Mall, across from the movie theater.
Hey Milwaukee, my name is Martina and I'm with the Independent Living Supports Pilot Program team. We help adults 55 plus and those 18 plus living with disabilities, providing up to $7,200 for home services, medical equipment, home modifications, and more. There's less than 30 days left to sign up for this program. See if you qualify today. Call 414-289-6874. Again, that's 414-289-6874. This program is made possible by Milwaukee County and Wisconsin Department of Health and Human Services.
Milwaukee Films Black Lens program aims to foster meaningful community conversations, promote celebration, and strengthen community bonds within and beyond the cinematic setting. Black Lens was created with a singular focus to spotlight the incredible work of filmmakers of African descent by bringing their films to the Milwaukee Film Festival. These filmmakers explore the stories, the topics, and the histories that are deeply shared throughout the Black diaspora while inviting diverse audience engagement. Now celebrating its commemorative 10th year, the Black Lens program has evolved beyond the festival, offering year-round film programming. This promises even more unique cinematic experiences, honoring the rich legacy of Black film while championing the contemporary wave of Black filmmakers. For more information on the Black Lens program, go to mkefilm.org.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee. WNOV 860 AM at 106.5 FM.
All right, welcome back. And, you know, the cool thing about my job is I get a chance to have conversations with some of the most interesting people, I think, on the planet, which is really cool. And so we were just talking off air, Deanna, and I found out that Theo went to Marquette High School. I'm not gonna hold it against him, though. I'm just not gonna do it.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Golden hate, right? But no, I really appreciate what you all are doing. In terms of this, the organization in general, but the recognition. So again, is there a website or a phone number? How do people, if they want to do a nomination, how would I do the nomination?
Yeah, so go to the website, mandiawards.com. So mandiawards.com. And there's all seven award categories are on there, and you pick the one that's right for the person or organization you want to nominate. And that's how Dion and her team will receive those nominations. And
okay. We have a caller. You all want to take some calls? Have you,
sure.
You spark some interest? Caller, welcome to the program.
Ooh, lost her.
Good morning.
Hey, how you doing? I had a question about something earlier with the financing, and I don't know if you can just speak, give me like 15 seconds of it. Okay, I have an opportunity to pay off all my bills, right? And I was just wondering, is that a good thing to do, to pay off everything versus leaving something on the table?
Oh, you're talking financial literacy. You're going to have to wait on that one, man.
I've been waiting all day, man. I need them answers, man. I can't do it with family because family give you a different perspective. I need an outside source. Is that a good idea or a bad idea?
Okay. I wish I could give you the answer. I prefer to have the expert give you an answer as opposed to I give you some bad answers and then you call in and said, dude.
It's not a bad nonsense. Answer because you have to evaluate everything you hear and then separate back from people.
Okay.
All right. I
appreciate
you.
All right. Yeah, we had someone on from U.S. Bank, and she was talking about financial literacy.
Oh, fantastic.
And this is Financial Literacy Month.
So. Absolutely.
All right. You back with us, Dion?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. And so you're saying the website people can go to if they want to nominate. When will the announcements be made? At the actual ceremony or prior to that?
So we'll announce the finalists. So as Dion described in the process, it's whittled down to two finalists in each category. We'll announce the finalists. I think that's in late May. But the actual winners won't be announced until the night of the event. So that's August 15th. And it's a surprise even to me. So that's why, again, I talked to you about the integrity of this whole process. Like, this is very much, this is like the Academy Awards. You know, no one knows the winner until it comes out live.
You get the reaction shots of the people that did win. Like, oh, great, hater. the cameras are on me. Got another caller. I think you can hit, I think you can do both. I think you can. Try it. So, yeah, I think you can.
Well, and then we also have a people's choice.
You're right.
So even if you didn't win in your category, the people voted for you. So we have a before the event online where people can vote for their choice.
Okay.
So there's an eighth category. So.
All right, caller, welcome to the program.
Good morning, all.
Good
I wanted
morning.
To know, how do a business get a part of, not the award ceremony, but a part of the organization period?
Oh, yeah, because I had that question, too. If I wanted to be part of LISC, how could I be a part of it?
Sure. So do you mean a part of our work in economic development, small business development? I would recommend brewcitymatch.com. So that's a website where we run a program in partnership with six commercial districts here in Milwaukee, as well as with a number of technical assistance and small business support organizations. So brewcitymatch.com. And we actually have an application process open there for some resources that we have for small business this year. So really recommend that.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right. All right, Dan's back.
Yes, I'm back.
If nothing else persisted, sorry about that. We thought we could do both. So as we close, I was really happy that I just met you, and so be able to hopefully meet you in person. But you know, we've had Theo just realize it's been like 4 years.
Yeah. Different roles.
Different roles, right? Different world. So you love music, right?
I do.
Dion, you love music?
I do.
Okay, here we go. All right.
No quizzes, though.
No quizzes. No.
I'm slow on the identifying the mystery song or tune right. in three.
Well, I can name that in three beats. Like, no, okay, name that tune. All right. So let's do. I'll start with you, Dion, if it's okay. All right. Let's do top five. You don't do top five. You can't do. Yes, you can. You can do top five. Let me. What are your favorite movies?
One of my favorite movies would be. I really like Set It Off.
That was a good one. I
like seeing something different than what you traditionally see in some of the characters. I really like Set It Off.
You like crime films? That was a good one. I have to give. All right. Here I go. Theo.
Oh, man. So I don't know that it's actually a great movie, but our family movie tradition, very unorthodox, is Four Brothers.
Dude, I'm so embarrassed. I love that movie. I am so embarrassed. That's one of my favorites.
We watch this every Christmas. This is people are like, "What's your favorite Christmas movie?" I was like, "Well, they're like, that's not a Christmas movie." I said, "Well, it starts on Thanksgiving, it ends on Christmas."
I was so embarrassed. I'm like, I'm actually liking this movie. I'm supposed to like this movie, but it was okay. All right. If a song or a type of music that you would listen to when you want to chill, or an artist you would listen to when you just want to chill.
I think chill for me would be, I'm a really big gospel fan.
Okay.
And so chill for me would be like a B.J. Putman or Donnie McClurkin. And a different kind of chill for me would be Mary Mary.
Okay. Oh, wow. Okay. I guess they're back together again. I don't know if it was Erica, the other sister. She's doing an individual interview. So they say, "How's your sister?" "We're not here to talk about my sister. We're here to talk about my project." It was like, "Right, it's your sister." Right. Come on. Wow.
Yeah, I saw that.
Did you see that? When she was like, "Oh," but I guess they're back performing together again. Mm-hmm.
Yes, back and forth. I don't know where they are right now.
They were doing a reality show. Was one of them doing a reality show?
They both were doing a reality show, and during the show they were going back and forth with doing it together, not doing it together, both of them doing their own thing. But Erica's really taken off and doing a lot of great things, and she even has her own radio show.
Okay.
I really respect her work.
Oh yeah, they were, and look, it's Sibs, and you know, Sibs are Sibs, man. I mean, you might have the same mom and daddy, but you know, you can be as different as day is long. So you chilling.
We listen. So personally, I'm like a Jay-Z fan, but
that's why I always
can't play at all with the family. So the more chill playlist is usually not controlled by me. Usually my wife is, you know, orchestrating that.
That is interesting.
So trying to do the old school stuff for the kids, make sure that they know.
Dion, you're a parent?
No, I'm not a parent. I've never given birth to any children, I got a whole lot of them around the community.
Oh man, I got a bunch of guy kids. I mean, man, and I'm telling, I put love in the wheel. I was just asking in general. When you say that, it's art. How young should a person be when we expose them to art? What is just art? I mean, you know, the bad words and everything, I understand. But I'm just wondering, how is there an age?
Yeah, I do play it now. I mean, now they're like teenagers. Okay. It's different. But yeah, it's hard to say, like, you can't say this. I don't want you saying this.
Because they are saying it.
And then with the stuff today, it's just... I'm like that.
Really?
Yeah, mostly, I can't. I just can't.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, which of these songs are going to be classics? Listen, that's man, what I'm having trouble.
Some of this stuff now that they got, it's like you wouldn't hear it like 10, 15 years down the line. And like how we have music that came out in the 90s and you're still playing it now.
Yeah, the 70s.
But like some of this stuff now, you like, I can't see it being around. But if these are the good old days, like they say, you know, after a while, they're going to be saying that these are the good old days. And boy,
we're in trouble.
We are in trouble.
You know what? I think we're more explicit. It's not like these words were just invented. You know what I mean? I mean, the reality, the words have always been there. I think now we're just more public with these words.
Well, I mean, like the old blues songs, they're saying... Ooh. They're saying the things, they're just not saying it.
They're just not saying it directly.
Where a child knows what they're saying.
Yeah, because some of the stuff that they were saying, you know, back in the day, like you wouldn't know, like you singing like Love Come Down, like, oh, this is a nice song. And when you get older and realize what the song is really talking about, you're like, oh.
I tell you the one for me. Me and Mrs. Jones.
Yes.
I was a kid when it came out, I would be jamming. Like, ooh. I became an adult. Oh, that's what they were singing about. Yeah. It's like Reasons, right? Philip Bailey said, people play this at weddings. It's kind of going like, this ain't a song you play at a wedding. Have you listened to the lyrics?
Yeah.
You know, so, yeah, I think the lyrical content is, I'm such a really believe, I really, really, obviously, because I do like public performance, I do radio. I'm really into protecting the First Amendment. Mm. And I just don't know if there's a line. All right, so let me ask a question. We were talking like your favorite movie. Here's my pet peeve: sequels. I think people fail. Most sequels fail. It's rare. The two exceptions off is obviously The Godfather, Godfather 2, Alien, Aliens. If you think about it, I don't know if you guys watch movies a lot. What do you think a movie that should not have had a remake or a sequel?
Okay, I feel like, don't shoot rocks at me for this when I say this, but I think Coming to America should have been left alone.
You're one of my favorite people ever.
Yeah.
Ever. You're absolutely correct.
Disappointed.
Disappointed. Yeah. The best part of the movie was the credits.
Yeah.
It was. The best part of the movie was the credits.
Outtakes.
Yeah. I'm going to give you one.
I supported it. I watched it. I appreciated it. But I felt like it should have been left alone.
Yeah. I got one for you. And I know my guy's a local. House Party.
Oh,
yeah.
I just heard. I didn't see it, but I just heard
that was like
for a star-studded cast.
It was. No, you got to. And, you know, we were talking, Deion, yesterday. Eric LaSalle was the only prominent person who did not appear in Coming to America. And he argued he would. Huh?
I said he sure didn't.
Yeah, yeah. And he was saying that it was his schedule. But look, you only shooting a couple of scenes. You can, yeah. So that was glaring, but maybe he didn't want to be a part of it.
Wow. Yeah, he was going to crash and burn.
I tell you, it turned out to be very good. The Best Man series. That has been.
That was excellent.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that was surprisingly good.
That was a binge. Mm-hmm. A binge weekend.
Really?
All the episodes.
Three of them, right?
Three? Is that joint that Tyler Perry produced?
But Tyler it was the one Best Man Christmas, and then the series.
Then the series, yeah.
And I think, then people are hoping that it's not over. I really think they can continue that.
Yeah, it was
really good.
And I'm a hater, but that turned out to be, I cannot believe I still enjoy Four Brothers. What is wrong with me?
Four Brothers was really good, man. It's like something that you can like watch all the way through without turning.
There's some
corny
lines in there though, too.
But the guy who was the bad guy, this dude has some real psychological issues. I mean, you just kind of going like, this dude is crazy, man. I mean, it was. Ooh, Four Brothers. You know, one of my favorites is Pootie Tang.
When that cat was singing.
hilarious.
You turn everything down and it's a hit. How you do that?
Oh my God, dude, hilarious.
Yeah, and the guy who played Pootie Tang is that's Lance Carruthers. He's a big director now, but he's offended when anybody comes up to refer to him as Pootie Tang.
Dude, that movie was way funnier.
As opposed to Mike Epps, who's saying, call me Day Day.
Yeah.
Day Day made a whole lot of money for me. Well, speaking of the Fridays, what do you,
Well, for me, I think Fridays was, the movies was pretty good. I think after the second one, they should have left it alone.
No, because we wouldn't have got to the third one, and we wouldn't have met Money Mike. We met Pinky.
Well, Pinky. Say something else. Say something.
What do you say, boys? I thought they were pretty decent. Yeah. Okay. I'm just, you know, always like to, you know, I think we deal with the business, but we're people too. I mean, we have those things that are very, very, very. I mean, we do things. We're more than just the work that we do.
I got a quick question for you.
Yeah.
Now, as far as cartoons,
you
know, back in the day,
as
far as cartoons, which cartoon would you want to see turned into a movie? Now, for me, I would love to see.
They did the Flintstones.
I would love. Now, Flintstones would have been good, but I would love
they
to see
do
something.
The Flintstones.
Really?
Yeah.
Sure did. Now, I would love to see like He-Man or like He-Man. Voltron or something like that.
Is that right? You like Voltron?
Or Silverhawks. Yeah.
I used to get home. I was working. I used to get home for Thundercats.
Oh my God. I love Thundercats. Thunder, thunder.
I don't know who would be, you know, they tried Scooby-Doo. Scooby-Doo wasn't, it didn't translate. I don't know. I think it's hard when you're trying to take television and put it into a movie. Mm. I think you also, it hurts when you're trying to do a movie and the television. I think they're visual, but they're two different kind of mediums in terms of what you're able to do in a movie. My favorite movie of all time, and I went to Catholic school and I was raised as a Baptist, is The Exorcist.
Oh, I could never watch that.
I didn't hear you, Dion. What'd you say?
No, I said, oh, wow. Like, I couldn't watch that.
Really? Oh, my God.
I will say this. Let me just say, I'm a PK.
Okay.
So it was a whole lot that we couldn't watch, a whole lot we couldn't listen to.
Okay.
So it's just some stuff when you're talking, it goes right over my head.
Is that right?
But I need to go to sleep at night. And so I can't watch stuff like that. And so I couldn't do it.
Yeah, man. It was like, for me, my scary one was the movie Carrie. When they poured the blood on her and they was doing it,
yes.
They're all going to be laughing at you. They're all going to be like, that scared me out of my legs.
That hand.
Oh, that coming hand. Up on the ground. Yeah,
the
man.
Greatest 30 seconds in film. That hand coming up. And everybody after that, everybody had that. And Friday the 13th, remember, Jason comes out the water. Everybody had that last shot. Right when you think you're going to walk out the theater.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget, me and my buddy went to see it. His sister had already seen it. So she went to see it again, and she goes, wait, because we're going to this movie when all that scared. She said, wait. I didn't sleep for 2 days after that.
Listen, man, when she locked everybody into the gym and got to looking around, I still see that now, and I saw that movie when I was little. So
that's why I can't do it.
Oh, my God.
Look at the people that was in that movie. John Travolta, Sissy Spacek.
Yeah.
There's a show on, I think it's on Netflix, maybe half hour, 45 minute show about movie cliches.
Uh-huh.
If you haven't watched it, you'll learn something. Like there's this scream, the scream sound effect that's been used for like 60 years.
Yeah.
And they play all the movies and you hear this identical scream that's been overlaid. I mean, there's just a bunch of stuff.
You haven't seen Friday the 13th, have you?
You know, I know about it.
Okay.
And I've seen pieces of it, but not I steer clear. I can't allow that stuff in.
But I'm not a
let me give you fan. Let me give you a little when you hear that.
Oh yeah.
You know what that is? Kill Mommy.
That's enough for me. I don't even need any more.
Kill Mommy. That's where that comes from. And John Carpenter figured it out. And it's John Carpenter used to do a lot of his own music.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's when listen to it is kill, 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 kill,
kill.
And that also, and I think they had to do these spoiler alerts after Jaws, because when they originally did Jaws, they didn't have the music letting you know the shark was coming, and people were having all kind of reactions to it. So if you notice, anytime the shark is around, you hear music. Right. So, because when they did the test on people, were like, whoa, that's just a little too much. But yeah, that's where it came from. Kill mommy.
A little warning.
Right.
Oh, wow.
It's coming.
And then there's I love political films, and there is All the King's Men, you've seen with Sean Penn.
Yep, Sean Penn.
But the original was Broderick Crawford. There's a lady in there who plays, her name is Mercedes McCambridge. Mm. They used her voice in The Exorcist. So when the demon is speaking, that's Mercedes McCambridge. And they did some computerizing. They slowed it down in such a way. So when you hear that voice, that's her voice.
I'm cool.
Because when I go to DC, I visit the stairs in Georgetown. Those stairs do exist.
Wow.
Sorry about that. I didn't mean to take you. What church were you at growing up? Your dad was a preacher here?
Well, we had something called, I grew up on 26 in Galena, and we had something called the Ministry Center.
Okay.
And my father used to do prison ministry. So we lived upstairs, and we had a duplex. We lived upstairs, and downstairs was a food pantry, a clothing pantry. My parents had Bible study once a week for kids and for adults. And then my father would go minister to people who were on death row, who were about to be executed. Oh, wow. He traveled across the country to do that.
I love Matthew 25 ministry. I think Matthew 25 is the basis of Christian ministry. And so your folks were a great example of that. And I guess that's why you're so involved with the community now, right?
Yeah, I got my parents in me for sure.
You know, it's funny. We're gonna take it real quick, but I had Priscilla Cox Jones, and we had Andrea Pratt. Mm. We were kidding them. We called them PKs, politicians' kids, and they talked about having to be dragged.
Oh yeah.
Andrea said even when she was here for Election Central, she said her father said, "Did you go check the polling place?" She said she'd been doing it since she was little. And then they were surprised that he even went into the business. You know? You're listening to Community Voice. We're up on the last break. We'll be right back.
Coming this month to Milwaukee Rep, Fiery Anthems from the High Priestess of Soul in Nina Simone for Women. This inspirational show shines a light on the civil rights icon, featuring live performances of hits like Everything Must Change and To Be Young, Gifted, and Black. Broadway World calls Nina's trailblazing journey riveting, relevant, and oh so real as she becomes the unforgettable voice behind impactful songs that you're going to love. Nina Simone for Women is at Milwaukee Rep April 16th to May 12th. Tickets at MilwaukeeRep.com. Calling all high school students. Do you act, sing, or play an instrument? Are you a scientist, filmmaker, playwright, or visual artist? If so, the NAACP Afro-Academic Cultural Technological Scientific Olympics program is for you. Sign up to compete in the local AXO competition on Sunday, April 21st. Gold medalists will automatically win an opportunity to compete at the National NAACP AXO competition in Las Vegas, Nevada this summer. With 32 AXO categories to choose from, there's definitely room to shine. For more information about the NAACP AXO program, visit NAACPMKE.org or call 414-562-1000.
Hi, my name is Tamika Vukovic, co-executive director of Wisconsin Voices. Please join Wisconsin Voices every Monday, Tuesday, and Friday. We will be focusing on community partnerships, voter education, and long-term collective impact for all Wisconsinites.
Hello, I am attorney Coral Plus, and I'm inviting you to join me for a new show here at WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM. You ask the name of the show? It's Money Talks with Attorney Coral, and it'll air each and every Thursday from 11 a.m. till 12 noon. We'll discuss financial literacy and what part Columbia Savings and Loan can play in your journey to financial freedom. Remember to join us each and every Thursday from 11 until noon, right here at 860 AM and 106.5 FM.
WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Inside Community Voice on WNOV 860 AM and 106.5 FM with your host, Keith Paris.
And welcome back. Just a few minutes. Theo and Dion, thank you all for being such good sports, having to deal with these trivia questions that I asked. Theo said, I didn't come over. I didn't know I was going to be talking about music. But I just always, like I said, this is the greatest job ever because I get a chance to meet very interesting people. And your backgrounds, it has a lot to do with where you are today. Oh. And so if people get an appreciation of that. So thank you.
Thank you for having me. No problem.
Hopefully you're coming back. So again, if we want to nominate someone, we can go where?
So mandyawards.com, M-A-N-D-I. awards.com. So I just really want to thank you, Keith, and WNOV for having us on and giving us some time to promote the Mandy's and just encourage people. You got a week left to get those nominations in. We can't say that people should have been recognized if we don't put them forward. If you know about them, put them forward, even if it's you.
Dion, anything from you?
Yeah, we're just excited to see nominations. I think those individuals who aren't thinking about applying probably are the ones who should be applying. And also those, if you're looking to nominate someone, involve them in the process so that you can get a lot of the rich information so that the selection committee can be aware of it.
All right. Did you want me to send you a copy of The Exorcist? I got the DVD.
You know, I'm good. I'm good.
I
sure? Offer.
I'm good. I can hook you up. I mean, if you.
I'm good. Okay. I like to sleep at night. I'm good.
I know. And I had Tubular Bells, which is that song you hear on my ringtone. Somebody, were you playing that devil music? I don't know. Maybe I'm the devil. I don't know. Maybe I'm a dancer.
Whose ringtone was that? Who was that assigned to?
That was just
right. General. That was your general ringtone. Yes, my general
ringtone. Wasn't my wife's ringtone.
I didn't say that. I just
she has one. She has one.
Man. Hopefully, it's sweeter than that.
Oh, it is. You know, there go my baby by Charlie Wilson. So okay. You know, it's all good. I thank you all. Theo, good seeing you again as always. Deanna, I hope to see you in person one day, get a chance to speak with you.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
So let me thank the good folks here at LISC and the Mandy Awards, Mr. Theo Liskin, Ms. Dion Grayson. Let me thank Treasurer Spencer Coggs, Alderman Chris Chambers, COO Modwella Kirkendall, all of you. Jermaine, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Carvey, thank you. Good Lord, will and creek don't rise. Hope to talk to everybody tomorrow. And as always, go from this place in peace.